funny, but it's actually.
So, so state governments and the federal governments spend billions of dollars every year trying to promote access to college. So, for instance, if you look before and after the Pell Grant program was started in 1973, there was no disproportionate increase in college enrollment by low-income families. If you look at differences between states in their tuition policies, there is some difference in college-going rates that's associated with the price that state universities charge for tuition. But that's a very expensive way to go about trying to promote access. And actually, it gets more and more expensive as college enrollment rates overall go up, because many, by definition, if a larger proportion of the population would have gone to college anyway, providing those subsidies is just being divided over a larger group of inframarginal people who would have gone to college anyway. So that's why, like, these novel approaches that Lindsay is going to be talking about today, not as substitutes, but as complements for these other federal and state programs for trying to promote access to college, are particularly interesting. So, like, could you generate a substantial improvement in college enrollment rates just by trying to make sure that people make better use of the existing programs that exist already? So Lindsay Page is going to be presenting on her work in Delaware and in Texas, studying the effects of these kinds of nudges and informational interventions. And Lindsay graduated from this program
2011,
worked for a couple years at CPIER, and is now at University of Pittsburgh. So let's welcome her back, and I think then we're going to go till like 5:15.
Okay.
Great.
The whole production. Hi, everybody. My name's Lindsay Page. People are so excited to hear this talk. They're streaming in from all angles. I'm really excited to be here. As Tom said, I'm a Hugsy graduate, so it's a particular honor to get to come back and share my work with you. The work, come in. The work that I'm going to present today, I am going to present on the paper that I sent, at least the Texas side of things. And then there's a new paper that I finished very recently in collaboration with Hunter Gelbach, who used to be on the faculty here. And I'm so excited about this paper that I didn't tell anybody I was going to talk about it, but I'm going to talk about that too. So don't worry, I'm not going any more rogue than that. So without further ado, I want to start off just by talking a little bit about the research that I've been involved in for a number of years. With my longtime collaborator, Ben Castleman, on the phenomenon of summer melt. One of the papers that I'm going to talk about, the second one, is a summer melt paper. And the first paper that I'm going to talk about really grew out of the work that Ben and I did on summer melt. So just very quickly, when we talk about summer melt, what do we mean by that? Basically, in between students getting admitted and committing to a college, and actually enrolling in college, during this summer of transition, there's a maze of activity that students need to wind their way through. So they need to do things like navigate, sort of finish up applying for financial aid. Sometimes they're navigating FAFSA verification. They're trying to understand their financial aid award letter. They're dealing with things like unanticipated fees or tuition payment plans. So there are a lot of steps in the financial aid process, college financing process, that students need to navigate during this summer. They also need to do things like attend orientation, do lots of paperwork. They need to figure out how they're going to get to campus. And it's a period of time where we're thinking about students who are 17, 18, 19 years old. They're not necessarily so hot with lots of complex tasks. We shouldn't necessarily expect them to be able to be responsible for all of the steps in their financial aid process. They have competing priorities and, importantly, a lack of support. So we've been engaged for a number of years in understanding this phenomenon of summer melt. We even wrote a book about it. And in the process of writing this book, there's a school counselor that I talked with, and the conversation that I had with her really has stuck with me for a long time. She said, "You know, Lindsay, you call this phenomenon summer melt, and that's cute, good for you. People are going to remember that. Very catchy. Congratulations." But the terminology of summer melt is really sort of a misnomer, because the challenges that students are facing in that summer of transition really begin in the winter, when they should be navigating the process of applying for financial aid. And so, so the struggles that she observed students to experience really began with the challenges that they had in completing the FAFSA process. And so what I want to do is transition to talking about a paper that we worked on that focuses not on all of these summer melt tasks, but focuses more narrowly on helping students navigate the process of completing the FAFSA. So what do we know about the FAFSA? The FAFSA is well known to be excessively complex. Really seminal work from Bridget Long and colleagues has shown us that if we provide students and families with help and support in completing the FAFSA when they're filing their tax returns, we can have big impacts on access to financial aid, on college access and persistence. But lots of families don't have access to the kind of help and support that they were offering in this particular study. And so as a result, many fail to file or fail to complete the FAFSA because of simple steps along the way. Maybe they don't provide their electronic signature properly. And students have gotten far enough in the process that they think they're done. They're waiting patiently for their financial aid package to come. And lo and behold, they don't know that they've never actually submitted the thing properly or gotten all the way through. What we also know is after the FAFSA is submitted, about a third, I don't think that these numbers are really all that well documented, but about a third of students, a third of FAFSA filers, are flagged federally for income verification. Income verification means that students need to provide additional documentation to prove, to document the information that they reported on the FAFSA. And what's particularly cumbersome about the income verification process is that it's completely decentralized. So if the federal government flags me for income verification, I need to separately complete verification at every university to which I've applied. Yep. And different colleges and universities can require different paperwork. Okay. So there's been a lot of attention on the FAFSA. One tool that until recently was quite helpful for families was the IRS data retrieval tool that went down. Thank you, executive branch. But what are some of the other strategies that have been put in place recently to help improve FAFSA filing rates? One is information. So over the past several years, maybe even for a 10-year period, I'm not sure how long this has existed, federal student aid, the federal government basically can push out student-level FAFSA filing information to school districts, to state agencies, to filter out to their schools so that schools can observe where their students are in the FAFSA filing process. So this is student-level data that's pushed out. It's updated regularly so that schools, in theory, can track where their students are in this process. A limitation of this, and this is, I will say, in my career, in the early stages of my career, a lot of research ideas and success of my career have grown out of my affiliation with the Strategic Data Project. And one conversation that I remember having at one of the SDP convenings was with fellows who worked in school districts who said, yeah, the school districts have these data. They just don't have the capacity to do anything with these data, to really make them actionable, to process the data properly, to figure out which students need what kind of support. So there's a limitation there in districts actually acting on those data. Other types of efforts to improve FAFSA filing rates are direct support opportunities, things like FAFSA completion events, College Goals Sunday, that are hosted in various communities. But a potential limitation there are for students and families to take advantage of them, they have to know that they exist. They have to be able to get there. It has to work with their schedule and so forth. So there's still some work that we can do to help students better navigate this process. So in this paper, and the paper that I'm presenting is collaborative work with Ben Castleman, again, and Catherine Meyer, who's a grad student at UVA. In this project, we were motivated by the work that we've done on summer melt, sort of a broader set of research in behavioral economics. We know from other studies that behaviorally informed outreach direct to individuals can improve their take-up of social benefits. So in this study, the Bagarva and Manoli paper, they are focusing on folks who are eligible for earned income tax credit benefits, but who don't actually take them up. And so they sent simple letters to families to remind them that this benefit was available to them. And lo and behold, sending people attractive letters that are easier to understand, that help them understand that there's a benefit for which they're eligible, improves their take-up of that benefit. And so in this study, we wanted to ask whether low-cost, behaviorally informed nudging, particularly about FAFSA, so we had a very narrow focus here just on FAFSA, whether it can improve rates of timely FAFSA filing, and in turn, college matriculation. This is the question, I'll give you the punchline right away. So the answers are yes and yes. So that's great, and I'm going to give you some of the details of this study over the next couple of slides. One thing that I forgot to say at the beginning is that if there are questions along the way, I'm glad to be stopped for questions. So in that spirit, I'll stop for a second and just see if there are any questions yet. No? Okay. But if questions come up, feel free to jump in. Okay, so what did we do? This is a text message study. I vowed to myself that one day I would stop doing text messages. So far, I've been engaged in a lot of text message studies. This is a study that we did in 8 school districts in Texas. So this included the Houston Independent School District, one other district in the Houston area, and then a set of school districts in the Austin, Texas area. And so some feasibility factors or some background information that's useful to understand why Texas is an ideal place to do this kind of work. So one thing that Texas does very well is data, particularly around college access and FAFSA filing. So in Texas, Texas has its own state-specific common application. So the majority of college goers in Texas stay in Texas when they go to college. And with the state-specific common application, students in Texas can apply to all of their state public universities and even some private universities in the state. So there's this portal that students use to apply to college. This portal also includes a school-facing, a counselor-facing component. So school counselors can actually know quite a lot about where their students are in the college-going process. If I were Luke's counselor, I would be able to log in and see that Luke was on page 8 of his Austin, Texas, or his UT Austin college application. Counselors can know quite a lot. By virtue of students having accounts in the Apply Texas portal, students also have to provide their cell phone information, or they can provide their cell phone information. The majority do. And when they provide their cell phone information, they're also given consent for that contact information to be used for educationally relevant outreach. The Apply Texas portal also is the portal through which the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board, a state-specific agency, pushes out student-level FAFSA filing information to the school counselors. So school counselors, it's regularly updated, and school counselors can observe whether a student has submitted a FAFSA, whether that FAFSA is complete, and whether the student has been federally flagged for income verification. So they have those three classifications for students. So what we did in Texas was we worked with a third-party technology provider and setting up the data sharing agreements to have this third-party provider work with all of the districts is no small feat. Just want to say that. So in any case, we made it happen where we set up these data sharing agreements between the districts and the third-party provider. So the third-party provider acting on behalf of the district could go into the Apply Texas portal, suck up all of the student-level data, sort students into bins according to where they were in the FAFSA process, and push out text messages to students that are informed by where we observe them to be in this process. So they were able to access and process the Apply Texas data, and as I said, customize messages according to students' FAFSA status. A thing that was really important for making this all happen and getting it off the ground, key collaborators, really like key champions for this work in each of the districts, and counselors in each of the participating schools. Because what we did was we pushed out text messages to students in all of our treatment schools. I'll talk about the study design in a second. When those messages went out, the ostensible sender of them was the student's counselor. And when, so those went out automatically, but when the student replied, that reply would come to the counselor in a web-based portal, and then the counselor could free-form communicate with the student. Now, one thing that's really interesting about this, if you're thinking about trying this at home, with something like a text message intervention, there were interesting things that we had to work through. For example, the districts had to decide, well, what time of day should we send messages out? And most schools had a policy around students not having cell phones during the day, so it didn't feel right to send text messages during the school day. Some schools decided that they would send text messages after school in the evening. One of the school districts decided that the best time to text their high school seniors was 6 o'clock in the morning. I know, because they thought, well, the students will get it before they get to school, this will be top of mind for them, and then the student could interact with the counselor during the school day. Okay. So the time frame for outreach was January through April 2015. We sent these automated, sort of semi-customized messages about once a week to high school seniors. And the messages had a few goals. So we wanted to remind students that it was FAFSA time. One other thing that was interesting about working in Texas was that if students are undocumented, and these districts had a relatively high share of undocumented students, those students were not, the FAFSA wasn't the right process for them. They should have been filing the TASFA, which is the state-specific version of the FAFSA where students can still access state aid. And so when we observed a student not to have submitted or completed a FAFSA, our messages had to be sensitive to the fact that they might need to be doing the TASFA instead. We wanted to provide students with feedback about their individual status. So if a student was flagged for income verification, we wanted to elevate that for the student and say, you're almost all the way through, but here's another step that you need to complete in order to actually access financial aid.
Okay, I think Tom has a question.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay, Lindsay. I was just going to ask, like, so information, like these nudges, one might hypothesize that they'd be even more impactful if there were some kind of trigger or priming, you know, mechanism beforehand. Like, so I was trying to think, like, are there some natural dates you could use? Like, if you knew from the College Board when they were sending the kids' test scores, if you could send a text message about finding that day, or if you knew when the parent-teacher conferences were scheduled at a particular school, like, sending, you know, the information, like, right around then, but like looking for other kinds of triggers that would make college sort of top of mind rather than, you know, I don't know, in Texas, we're, you know, thinking about the Final Four or something.
Right.
You're not, your head may not be in the college building space.
Yeah, it's a good question. I guess in this instance, we were messaging students once a week. I think this is probably more of a brute force model, where we just said, you know, we're going to try to raise this, you know, in what would be high time, sort of high season for FAFSA filing. In the second paper that I talk about, it's a similar kind of nudge intervention from the vantage point of the university, with the university reaching out to admitted students. And there, the university has better information about sort of the timeliness of various tasks that students need to do, and again, data on whether or not they've done them. So so in that instance, the outreach was more timed to all of the relevant deadlines through the summer. Yeah. We did try, in the messaging, we did try to raise awareness for things like priority filing deadlines. So in Texas, for example, a lot of the universities and colleges have priority filing deadlines that are pretty early, you know, March 15th, a full month before the taxes would have been filed. So we did try to raise awareness for those kinds of deadlines.
Yeah. I was just thinking, like, in terms of trying to be aware of other things going on in the person's life that are not, I mean, in the case of the filing deadline, you're still trying to penetrate,
mm-hmm.
you're trying to say, hey, look, you should be paying attention to X.
Right.
But if there are other events that are happening, like they've just gotten their scores from the College Board, that mean that would lead you to believe they'd be ready for a message.
Right.
You know.
Right. Yeah. No, it's
or if Google could let you know when they're searching on, you know, before at, you know, University of Texas.
Right.
You know.
Yeah. Yeah. Beth.
Are you able to observe, like, how many texts it takes to get someone to file, or if there are particular times of the, you know, within the period that seem to, like, really, you know, make a bigger impact than others?
So I'll show you the trajectories of completion over time, and I'll note that these trajectories so far, you know, one thing that we learned, and this is getting a little more into the weeds of sort of the implementation, one thing that we did learn was this student-level FAFSA filing data, once it filters through all of the data matching that has to happen to get it back to the school, what the schools get is imperfect. And so in some cases, we would be sending a message to a student that says, student, our data as of this date says you haven't filed the FAFSA. And the student would write back and say, no, but yes, I did. And either there was a lag in the data or there were imperfections in the data match. So I'm still working through all of that. And so as a result, I'm going to show you the school level data that's available through federal student aid online at the high school level. But not yet the student level data. Yeah.
Were there other questions?
Yeah.
Just a brief question. I thought, sort of also with the sort of behavioral hat on, I'm wondering about, like, students, these students are pretty savvy about text messaging and, like, where, how text messages get created. And I'm wondering if you have any sense of whether they were put off by the fact that it was a computer that was supposedly sending something ostensibly from their counselor.
So
which might mute the effect if they sort of,
right, if they start tuning it out.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it is a concern. We do have the data on and I don't include it in the slides, but how often they're responding and when they're engaging and so forth. And students do respond and engage.
Yeah.
I'd have to look at the engagement over time.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It's a good question. The second paper that I'm going to talk about is actually, so remember when students responded to this, when they sent a response, it went to a counselor, it went to a human. In the second paper that I'm going to talk about, it primarily goes to a chatbot. So I'll talk more about that in a second. But even in that instance, we did some focus groups with students about how they felt about it, and in general, they liked it. Yeah. Okay. Did I cover everything on here? Yeah. In terms of research design, just one slide on research design. Our sample included 66 high schools across these 8 districts in Texas. We grouped schools by a lagged measure of college going and then randomized within those groups. So in the treatment schools, students got this proactive text-based outreach, or at least the subset of students who had valid cell phone information in the Apply Texas portal. And that was about 75, on average across the schools, it was about 75% of seniors. And then in the control schools, they just got business as usual. So I will say that in some of the control schools, this portal was something that they already had access to. And so we did observe some text activity over the same period of time. It was on a much wider range of topics. And in our treatment schools, there was a much higher concentration of messages specifically about the FAFSA. Across all of the schools and districts, our sample includes over 17,000 students. So it's nice to work in Texas, I guess.
Could students opt out once they receive a text message? Is there some sort of requirement that said, you know, text stop if you don't want to get these messages?
Yep, exactly. And when I get to the second paper, I'll show you an example of one of those first messages. I think by law, when you start this kind of campaign, the first message has to, you know, you really want to sort of set up for students, here's who this is, here's why you're getting this message, but if you don't want it, just text stop. Yep. Okay. So just in the interest of time, I'm not including a lot of the detail about the text content and so forth. It's either in the paper or if you'd like sort of examples of text messages or files of text messages, I'm glad to send them to you. So this is just a graphic looking at impact on FAFSA completion. So what we have along the x-axis is time. The outreach began in January, so here we're looking several weeks in. And with these are the data from Federal Student Aid. So the earliest that they reported for this cohort is this date in February. So the solid line are the controlled schools. The dotted line it represents the treatment schools. And this vertical line in red represents the end date, the last time that we sent a text message. So I'm tracking the trajectories into the summer, but the messaging actually stopped here. So it's just happening in the spring of their senior year. And what we see is a little bit hard to see with these trends, but what we see is a positive and statistically significant impact on FAFSA filing, particularly in the early weeks. And when we actually model this, over time, these trends converge to the differences not being statistically significant later in the summer. And so what that says to me is that this messaging is having maybe a small bump on FAFSA filing overall, but really quite a big bump on the timing with which students are filing the FAFSA. They're getting it done a lot earlier. So students aren't necessarily still having to navigate FAFSA filing in that sort of summer melt range, but instead they're getting it done at higher rates during the school year. Yeah?
So that looks like an additive effect, right, in the sense that it's exactly the same difference across all of that? So doesn't that, would that suggest that the treatment effect is really happening in February and you could really text between January and March and you wouldn't even need to text after that?
Right.
So we didn't
really test, you know, obviously we didn't test that. We were just sort of tracking this over time. But it does seem like must be
the early part, and then it's just maintaining from there.
Exactly.
Like after you've got this difference.
And in, as I said, you know, one thing that we tried to make salient for students was that many of the schools had these early deadlines. And so, you know, hopefully one thing that we were doing was pushing them to complete a lot earlier. So the other thing that we're able to do is link students up to data from the National Student Clearinghouse. And we also see sort of conversion of effects to timely college enrollment. So one thing I should note is that these are all students who we might define as college intending. These are students who had applications in the Apply Texas portal. So they at least made motions towards or sort of signaling to someone, or they were sort of feet were held to the fire and they had a college application. But we see a positive effect on overall college enrollment, and particularly on four-year college enrollment, with a small negative, not statistically significant impact on two-year college enrollment. So one thing that's interesting to me is that the magnitude of these effects are really similar to the magnitude of effects that we see in our summer melt research. And so it, at least in my mind, while I can't test this hypothesis in particular, it lines up for me with the notion that a lot of the challenges that students face in that summer of transition may be particularly tied up in this process of completing the FAFSA, navigating income verification, so that if we're able to help students do that earlier, they may have better results in terms of college enrollment. So I want to do one more slide just to wrap up this paper, and then transition to the other paper that I want to tell you about. So just in terms of potential mechanisms, how might this kind of outreach be helping students achieve their college goals? Of course, if they're completing the FAFSA, they're accessing financial aid, whereas they might not have been accessing it before with FAFSA completion. One other thing that we saw, and this was one thing that I think stuck out to me most in the data, when we look just descriptively at students who are flagged for income verification, the students who are flagged for income verification are more likely to be from low-income backgrounds. And again, descriptively, we see that students who are flagged for income verification in our control schools are about 6 percentage points less likely to actually enroll after we condition on everything that we can observe for students. And when we look at that differential, so students who have probably applied to college, they've submitted their FAFSA, those who are flagged for income verification are 6 percentage points less likely to actually enroll. That seems like a big difference to me. In our treatment schools, we saw that differential was more like 3 or 4 percentage points. Now, in our data, that difference between 6 percentage points and 3 or 4 percentage points is not a statistically significant improvement, but it's at least moving in the right direction. And it says to me that one potential mechanism is that this outreach is helping to make the selection for income verification more salient for students. It's helping students realize that they've been flagged for income verification and hopefully helps them understand that they need to navigate this process better. And then, of course, accessing more financial aid. So again, descriptively, we see by looking at data like the NIPSAS sort of national surveys of financial aid, that students who complete the FAFSA earlier access more financial aid, even once you condition on the types of institutions to which they're applying. And so while we can't observe it in these data specifically, it may be that students who are filing the FAFSA earlier are also accessing more financial aid as a result. So I'm going to pause there for a second because I'm going to switch gears to tell you about this second paper that I want to share with you, definitely in the same theme. But before I do that, I just want to see if there are any questions. Yeah.
How costly was it to work with a third-party vendor, and how reasonable would it be for a school district to do that?
Mm-hmm. So this work was funded by the Gates Foundation. Thank you, Gates Foundation. Thank you, Gates Foundation. And it was, I think we had a grant for a little over $100,000, and I think $60,000 of that went to the technology provider. So if you think about sort of spreading that out over, 10,000 kids or whatever it is, it was about $6 a student. So it's not nothing, but it's not tons and tons and tons.
That seems expensive. Mm-hmm. It includes their profit. Yep. I want the profit back. It seems like that price should come down.
Yeah, and it probably come down
with volume, I bet, right?
Yeah.
Another cost question is about the counselors who are responding. Do you have any measure of
sort of time,
how much extra time they spent, or whether they shift what they shifted their time away from in order to respond to the?
It's a good question. So when we've done this kind of work in the summer, we have paid counselors for their time since they're not on contract. For this work, we convinced the districts that this could be included as a regular piece of the counselor's work. But I don't have that kind of sort of understanding what they're not doing as a result of doing this.
I mean, it might be interesting. You might be saving them time. Like, if normally they'd be spending a lot of time running around reminding kids that the deadline's coming up.
Right. And that's
how the text messaging is doing that.
That's at least how we pitched it to them, to say, if it is. So I'm going to finish answering this, but I'm just going to notice out loud that the only hands that I'm seeing are faculty and PhD hands. I'm just pointing it out to those of you I spoke with earlier today. So I'm just saying so. Now I don't even remember what I was going to say. Right, so we tried to pitch it to them as saying, look, if it's your responsibility to sort all of these spreadsheets and figure out who needs to be doing what, we're going to take that responsibility away from you. You don't need to be looking at those spreadsheets anymore because we're handling this automatically for you.
Do you have any data on what modes of communication students most likely use with their counselors and follow-up? Like, do they mostly text message back, or do they go in and see them?
It's a great question. So when they text message back, we are able to observe that. If they go in and see them, we didn't ask the counselors to keep logs on that. In fact, there was variable appetite, actually, from the counselors in engaging in the text messaging. And so in we gave the districts the opportunity to tailor the message content a little bit. And we would give them sort of, you know, here's the message that we crafted. Change it the way you need it to be changed. And some of them, anywhere that it said, text me back, they would scratch that out and be like, come visit me in office 305, because that was really how they operated.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
In the study schools, is there a variation in the counselor to student ratio?
Yes. Yeah. So the schools were really a variable size.
But in terms of like numbers of students assigned to a given counselor, were you able to see if counselors had greater loads if the programs?
It's a great question. So that's not one of the dimensions on which I've sliced the data, but I will look at that because it's a great question. Yeah. Yeah.
Partly because I'm sitting next to Luke thinking about treatment effect heterogeneity today. I'm thinking, I wonder if you could predict which kinds of students this works best for. This seems like a particular case in which if you could understand in advance, you don't need to maybe target all of the students at the school. Maybe there's a particular subset.
Yeah.
And since you are in the case that that's looking at individual level moderators, you have a lot more power even than for the mean effects here.
Right.
So you actually may have some leverage on thinking about not so much just for understanding heterogeneity, but thinking about how you could target
right.
this, which may drive the cost down.
Yeah.
Then too, if you're targeting.
Yeah. I mean, really, really, when I think about cost, you know, this intervention was sort of a one-off focused on FAFSA filing, but really, my hope would be that this kind of system could be used more broadly. So that's sort of one thought on the cost. But I agree with you that so far I just haven't gotten far enough in the analysis
really
to think about all of that
yeah.
variation. But there's a lot of opportunity there. Yeah. There's a hand in the back.
It was the same. It was the ratio
okay.
question.
Okay. So why don't I go on? But for every faculty hand, there has to be at least two student questions. So faculty, no more questions until I get two student questions. Okay. I'm talking, so I get to set the rules, I guess. Okay. This was a graphic that I showed you at the beginning. And so what I want to do is shift now to a paper that is now a, you know, at one point I vowed that I would never do any more summer melt papers, but then this opportunity came along and I couldn't turn it down, so I want to tell you about it. Okay. So this is a partnership with Georgia State University down in Atlanta. And just to tell you a little bit about Georgia State University, if you've been following the popular press recently, you may have seen Georgia State in the news a lot for a lot of stuff that they have going on to improve rates of college access and college success for their students. So the Georgia State population, the majority of their incoming students are Pell eligible. About a third of their admitted students are first generation college goers. And over the past couple of years, for the several cohorts of students, they've recognized that even among students who commit to Georgia State, they've observed a high rate of summer melt. And so this project is a collaboration, as I mentioned before, on the research side with Hunter Gelbach, on the implementation side with a startup actually here in Cambridge called AdmitHub. And AdmitHub and Georgia State had been having conversations about how the AdmitHub technology might be useful to Georgia State. And it was in those initial conversations where Georgia State really said, you know, maybe you can help us with this summer melt challenge that we're having. And everybody said summer melt, and then they decided to give me a call, and voila, I was involved too. Okay, what AdmitHub developed for Georgia State was a text messaging platform. Now, what's cool about this, there's so many things that's cool about this. In working with the university had perfect information about what students needed to be doing in order to transition successfully from committing to Georgia State to actually enrolling. And in the context of my own work on Summer Melt, this was actually the first time that we were doing this work from the perspective of the university. All of the other summer melt work that I've been engaged in has been more from the high school side, that we said, we know the students said they want to go to Babson, wherever, and we're going to support them over the summer and see if they actually enroll. But what they do along the way, the student basically has to know what those steps are. We can take our best guess. but we can't actually track their success and progress. In this intervention, we were able to articulate all of those tasks that students needed to do, and then we could integrate outreach with their student information system, just as we did in the FAFSA paper. In the FAFSA paper, we could know if a student had been flagged for income verification. Here we could know, did the student commit? Did they submit their FAFSA? Did they sign their master promissory note? Did they select their meal plan? Did they tell us if they needed parking? On and on and on and on. We could know everything about the student. And so what AdmitHub built for Georgia State was a chatbot named Pounce, named after their mascot. And Pounce did a few things over the summer. Pounce would send students reminders of the things that students needed to do over the summer. We were able to target that outreach only to students who had not yet completed a given task that was due. Right, so we were able to focus on the deadlines that students needed to meet, and if they weren't meeting those deadlines, Pounce could reach out to the student. Pounce included a bunch of workflows for all of these tasks, so students could follow guided tutorials through how to complete things, and it also has a survey function. What's cool about Pounce, I'm now a total champion for Pittsburgh. This is a picture of Pittsburgh. Chris will recognize it at least. If you come to Pittsburgh now, you'll see these cars all over the place. These are Uber's self-driving cars. And so you can actually take a self-driving Uber around the city if you're traveling in certain places. So the technology that Pounce is built on is the same technology that Uber's self-driving cars are built on. So how do the self-driving cars work? They basically have to, these cars with their sensors all over them will drive around the city, sort of mapped trajectories, mapped pathways, over and over and over again to build a very detailed multi-layered map for how they need to get from point A to point B. And over time, that's going to, with a lot of human support, that's going to build up the artificial intelligence to eventually drive the car on its own. Okay, so I want you to think about that analogy of the self-driving car. I can literally look out my office window and see them driving around. So I want you to think about that analogy now with Summer Melt. We're building the AI technology to support students in this pathway from being committed to Georgia State to actually enrolling. Okay. So what did AdmitHub do? They built these guided pathways for students for all of the tasks that they needed to navigate from committing to the university to actually enrolling. So as I said before, these are tasks like, they're kind of mundane when you list them out like this, right? Did they register for orientation and attend? Did they submit their transcript? Did they submit their housing deposit? Blah, blah, blah. Right, lots of stuff that students need to navigate. So just to give you an example, this is just sort of one step in a pathway. A student would get a text that would say, hey, first name, do you plan to park a car on campus? And then depending on whether the student said yes or no, it had branching logic for guiding students. Now students could respond yes or no, or they could ask a free form question that maybe had something to do with parking, or maybe had nothing to do with parking. The whole system was seeded with a bunch of information so that depending on the question that students asked, sometimes the system could just freeform create a response, sort of dig into that knowledge base and create a response for students. If it couldn't do that, the question was kicked upstairs to an actual admissions officer via email. That happened automatically, and the admissions officer could respond to the question via email, and that response would filter back to the student. It would filter back to the student through the technology partner. They would take a look at it and use that response to continue to build the knowledge base. So that next time a student asked that question, the system could answer it automatically rather than having to get the counselor involved. Okay, so this is one sort of workflow. This is another workflow. Can you guess what this workflow is for? Sit loud and proud. FAFSA. This is the workflow that they built, or a graphic for the workflow that they built around applying for financial aid. Just to give you a visual for how complicated that can be.
Okay, so just to give you an example, and this gets to the question of Blake, right? Your question about like what's the first message?
Yeah.
Okay, so this was the actual first message. So, hi Mike, congrats on being admitted to Georgia State, yay! I'm Pounce, your official guide. I'm here to answer your questions and keep you on track for college. Standard text messaging rates may apply. Would you like my help? And Mike might write back, can I bring my dog? And this was a piece of information that was already in the system, and so the system can just reply. Okay. So we did this. We implemented Pounce in the context of an RCT. We did this just last summer. We targeted admitted students with a U.S. cell phone. We had about 2,000 students in our sample who, at the start of the RCT, already filed their paperwork to commit to Georgia State, and then a bunch of other students who were admitted but who never filed, or at least at the start of our RCT, hadn't committed to Georgia State. We ran a randomized controlled trial. We stratified by GSU commitment status at the time of randomization, and as I said before, we integrated Pounce outreach with the student information system. So we were only, we were able to be much more targeted. We were only reaching out to students if there was something that they needed to accomplish that was not yet accomplished. Okay. In terms of the system learning over time, in pink represents, this is just sort of a gestalt. You can think of time across the x-axis. And what you can see is that the system was getting smarter over time. So the pinky purple represents all of the incoming student questions that were handled automatically, either by those workflows or through the AI that was actually able to answer questions. In the middle represents our supervised machine learning. So what does that mean? Basically, whenever a question came into the system, the AI would generate a potential response. And there was a kind of a confidence interval or a confidence score associated with how good the system felt about that response. And if the confidence level was high enough, the response would just go to the student. And if the confidence level wasn't high enough, then the AdmitHub system engineers would take a look at that response, tinker with it if they needed to, and then have it go out. But by doing that tinkering, by scoring and sort of giving a reaction to the system, they were feeding information into it so that over time, the system was getting better at answering student questions. And up in yellow, you can see that a very small share of the questions actually had to be handled by an admissions team. Okay. Anyway. So what's particularly exciting to me, as I said, is that from a summer melt standpoint, we can actually observe not just impacts on matriculation. So these are outcomes, I should say, and emphasize, just for the students who at the start of our RCT were committed to Georgia State. We had zero impact for the students who were not committed to Georgia State. Okay, so no impacts there. And the paper includes the no impacts. I'm not trying to hide them from you. But no impacts for the students who applied and were accepted to Georgia State, but not admitted. Yeah.
Very small question. These logits are percentages?
Sorry, percentages.
Okay.
Yep, or percentage points. Thank you. So what do we see? We saw a 3.3 percentage point impact on matriculation to GSU. This is GSU specific. We also looked at NSC data, and we don't see that we're scooping students away from other four-year institutions. It's basically that they would have enrolled here or not enrolled at all. But again, from a summer melt standpoint, what's exciting to me is that we can see impacts on a lot of the process steps that students need to navigate over the summer. So this is I've cherry-picked here the outcomes where we see positive effects. We saw zero effects on things like submitting your housing paperwork. It doesn't seem like that's really holding students up. But where we very consistently saw positive impacts are on everything to do with financial aid. So did they have a verification hold on their financial aid? We reduced that. Did they complete loan counseling, a positive effect of 6.3 percentage points? Did they accept loans? And then some other sort of process measures as well. So what's exciting to me about this is that, again, from a research standpoint, we're able to observe improvement on all of those process steps and see how that contributes to improvements in timely enrollment. Last slide. So just in conclusion, what do I take away from this? I think both of these papers provide evidence that data-informed outreach can help support students through these key college transition steps. Does it mean, particularly the second paper, should we replace school counselors and admissions staff with chatbots? No! And I'm not just saying that because I have friends who are school counselors. What we see, or what I'd like to think at least, is that systems like Pounce, systems like this FAFSA text messaging, can help improve staff efficiency. That what we see in Pounce in particular, students are asking the same questions over and over again. They're getting hung up in the same place. And so if we can build efficient systems to help students or keep students from getting hung up in those places, then counselors can devote their time to more complex challenges. So we can efficiently use data to target those who need outreach. The AI in Pounce can handle common student questions and improve over time in doing so. And this is an analogy that I like in particular. So far, the self-driving cars don't operate particularly well in bad weather. And so just as you would think that the AI can't handle that sort of very rocky or challenging terrain, what we would hope to do is save staff time for complex circumstances that don't revolve around simple answers to relatively simple questions. So that's everything. I want to acknowledge all of my collaborators in this work, both research partners and implementation partners. Please feel free to get in touch with me, and I think we have about 10 minutes for questions. Yep, nope, Tom, you're not allowed to ask your questions.
I know there were at least 200 questions.
So you're not going to ask yours, right? You're going to let Olivia go first.
Hold on. Olivia, go ahead.
I was just wondering, did you see larger treatment effects for first-generation students? It seems like there's a high percentage of them.
It's interesting. At Georgia State, no. I didn't really see evidence of that. I did look, but I didn't really see it. Okay, Tom, now you
can answer. So I'm intrigued by the finding you reported on how you had an effect on things related to financial aid, but not on other things like housing. And at first I was thinking, oh, is that saying something about, you know, people are more likely to procrastinate around financial things? But it could also be, and this related to the question the woman asked earlier, and that is, like, could it be that the kind of people who are more likely to be eligible for financial aid are the folks who were affected by this? So, like, if you look at some of these, if you could identify people who would have been eligible for financial aid in treatment and control, and then just ask, like, did this have an effect on everything, including housing,
right,
for that group?
That's like, a good point. Yeah. That's a nice suggestion. So the trick would be, I have zip code. I could probably do it by zip code. That's a great idea. Okay, yeah, thank you. That's helpful.
I know you've sworn off doing more successor studies in the future, but if you were, would you consider randomly assigning the time of day you sent out the message? You could figure out when students are most responsive and maybe use that info to drive costs down?
Yeah, we, so where'd Chris go? Chris left. So we had a bigger text message study that Chris Avery has worked on, and we've been collaborating on. It actually sits administratively at CPR, where we've messaged students through their entire senior year, actually starting in their junior year into senior year and into college. And it's sort of quasi-random, either the day of the week that we message them, and kind of quasi-random the time of day that we message them. So we can look at some of that variation. I haven't looked at it yet, but of the studies that I've been involved in, that's probably our best opportunity. Yeah. Well, you know, one paper that I saw suggests that if you really want to hold people's attention with this kind of outreach over time, you should randomly vary the day of the week and the time of day that you're messaging to them. so that it feels more natural and less automated. Yeah, so it's a great question. Yeah.
So with your FAFSA study, right, part of you think there's like this advantage to getting students to file earlier so it's like not on their heads. And I was wondering if there's any outcomes you're collecting on the sort of college level of like early like orientation week, like getting, I don't know, like is it enabling students to get their stuff together more in that like key early week when they like would, like, they might get stuck, like, having to fill out housing forms, but instead they can, like, make sure to get their books or, like,
right.
have their syllabuses reviewed.
Yeah.
And, like, a similar sort of, like, is this getting them prepared?
Right, and is a positive impact persisting over time?
Yeah.
So I think Georgia State collects a lot of data on their students. I don't think they'd mind me saying that. So we haven't gotten additional waves of data for enrollees yet, but it seems like that would be a good opportunity to do so. So it's a good suggestion. Yeah.
I think maybe in like other papers you've addressed this, but do you have information about like degree completion or like GPA or other things that would happen after matriculation? Because like there could be one model of decision making that I don't necessarily think is true, but where you like nudge people just over the FAFSA completion, but maybe they were hesitating on that because they were like, is this the right school for me at all, right, a match?
So. Yeah. So far, in one of our early summer MEL papers, we followed students into their sophomore year. We're actually in the process now of doing more of a longer run follow-up to see if any of those impacts persist. So it's coming, but I don't know the answer yet. Yeah.
So some schools with financial aid have limited resources, and so the benefit to applying early is that you get more of that
right.
financial aid. Can you tell at all if there's a negative effect on the control group because now they're applying later and there's less money available for them? So on net, especially like in one state, you may just be reallocating
resources. That's a really good point. I could probably get those data from Georgia State. Ask me a different kind of question. These are all like, I could do that. Here's where I could do that. But yeah, I think Georgia State would be a place where I could. Answer that. It's a good point. Yeah, like
With the Georgia State study, did you get feedback from the counselors? Like, did they feel like this like measurably decreased their workload, or were they like excited about the way that this changed what they were able to allocate their time toward?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I think we were focused more on how the students perceived it and whether the students would negatively react to this sort of chatbot interaction. And in general, they didn't. That could be a total selection effect for who would be willing to come and participate in our focus groups. In general, I think the counselors and admissions staff were really happy to have this. My sense is that admissions offices, particularly in the summer, work on sort of a skeleton crew. You know, they're not teaming with staff members. So if you can, you know, whatever you can do to help make them more efficient is at least in this instance, was welcomed. And they really needed to be a partner in, we would craft, or really Admit Hub would craft these workflows. I would provide feedback on them. They would provide feedback on them so that we were sure that the language was accurately representing the kind of advice and information that the counselors or the admission staff would give to students.
So was there some rough proxy for this process happening in the absence of Admit Hub? Like, were they sending out form letters like, hey, your FAFSA is overdue, or you know, you didn't send in your orientation form or anything like that?
It's a good question. I'm actually not sure that, like, how much by hand follow-up they were doing. So it's a good question. But, you know, my guess is either no, or if they were, it was not particular, like, it was not being as effective as they wanted it to be, because they, you know, when we began having these conversations, they were really signaling summer melt as a challenge that they wanted to work on. Yeah. There's a hand over here. Yeah.
Lindsay.
Yeah.
Hi. Dan Peterson from Admit Hub.
You can talk all about it.
Great to meet you.
I only know them online.
Conference calls, yes.
Yeah.
Lots of time. I could speak briefly to
yeah.
that. That they have email campaigns that in many ways would mirror what we were trying to do with the text messaging. But they were at the point where the open rates and the response rates of email, as you all know, from a marketing perspective, are really low. If it was 20 or 30%, that would be considered good. And the text message engagement rate, I can't remember off the top of my head, but it was
really high.
Over 80%, maybe even 88%, close to 90%.
Yeah.
So I think that alone, struggling to engage with a scale of a high volume of students, that alone was sort of the difference for them to think that this outreach was happening in real time. And the results, obviously, everyone was really happy about that, to the point where we're going to now continue into some of the questions that you all have raised about retention and beyond enrollment, to start forging into how can we continue to support students on the path to graduation.
Thanks. Yeah.
I have two questions, and maybe you'll be able to answer these. But
within
within a given topic, did you guys do any A/B testing on like the language of particular messages? And then also, have you looked at doing any like clustering unsupervised learning to look at potential profiles of how students are interacting with this thing over time, and like the path from starting out to getting through all the work?
For A/B testing, the answer is yes, but not as much as we would have liked to. We have that built in, and it's something that we're using sort of on a case-by-case basis. I mean, obviously, we're really focused on getting the messaging right and seeing which is more effective. So the A/B testing will be absolutely crucial to that. I'm not sure. Could you repeat the second question again?
So you have all this data about how students interact with this thing over time, like how many messages they get as they move from step one to step two, or as they're dealing with the housing part of this and that. And I imagine that students fall into these clusters of like, how many messages did it take to get me through this step? Did I like get one message and continually progress each time? That's like one profile you could imagine.
Yeah.
So this is the type of thing you'd look for with like unsupervised learning. Maybe you can cluster some behaviors together and then get some different profiles of students.
For how different types of students interact with the system.
Right, and that would also be interesting to look at that behavior and how it connects to future performance.
Yeah,
that's a great question. I think the analytics piece and tapping deeper into the data, there's tons of uncharted territory there that we're really interested in trying to sift through those things.
Dissertation.
I'd be happy to give you my card if you would like to lead this effort.
Yeah, great. I'm so glad you're here.
I was curious, I just missed a couple of details. If you can go back a couple of slides. And in your results, So for accepting loan, is that saying that of the people that need a loan, only 45% accept it, and there's a 5% bump, or is that 45% of the overall?
So in the control group, about 45%. I can't observe, at least in the data that I've looked at so far. I've looked at these outcomes, but I haven't conditioned on needing a loan.
Okay.
So it's just sort of the raw rate in the control group, 45%. Accepted a loan, and in the treatment group, it was 5.5 percentage points higher.
So if you actually think about probably the pool that actually needs a loan, your treatment effect
is larger.
It's like 10% possibly.
Yeah.
Or something.
Yeah.
Okay. And the other question is, you talked about this machine learning piece. Are you saying the machine learning piece was had a list of possible responses that it would pick from, or was it actually generating language?
I think it was generating language.
Not generating. It's a list currently. Moving to a generative model would be farther out.
Way far out.
We need a lot more data to be able to do that. The idea is we could start with like snippets.
So you have like 100 or 200 or 500 possible factoids. And
correct,
then
yeah. We call it an understanding, if you will, right? Where you could have a dozen or more different ways of sort of asking that question.
Right, and we're trying to map to.
Yeah, I think we started with about 200 understandings, if you will, with Georgia State, and by the end of the study, we're up to 1,200 and counting now.
Yeah.
And the extra ones are generated, so the counselors, as soon as they generate an answer, you add that into your pool of things to use in future text messages.
Correct.
Thank you.
So we're out of time, I think, so. Okay, we're out of time. No more questions.
Great. So, thanks for being here. If you have additional questions for Lindsay, we have a reception in the room next door for the next, a half hour or so.
Thanks.
Yeah.